I think I'm convalescing. I suspect that the more that I talk, the more hoarse and hoary I'm going to get. Hello, yeah. And welcome to Copy That, the only copywriting morning show in existence. I am one of your co-hosts, Sean, and this is Luke, and this is Rod. I decided upon this topic because I wanted to make a clickbaity title for the video that's eventually going to be on YouTube based on this particular discussion. How do I get started? If I want to do a copy, how do I even begin to copy? What even is a copy? What is in all is entailed in the act of copy? If one were to go from zero to copy, what are the intermediary steps? The one mistake that I see people making when they ask the question and when they try to answer it is operating under the assumption that there is an answer. Today, we're all going to give our origin story and give advice to everybody listening now and in the future about what to do to actually start a career in copywriting. A lot of my success has come from the fact that, like, I've actually gone on adventures and done stuff along the way to, like, writing about the things that I'm seeing and experiencing. My copywriting career has taken me to Dubai, to Brazil, to Japan, to England, to Amsterdam, to France, to Ireland, to all over the United States. I've traveled a lot purely because of my career in copywriting.
I don't think any of us can compete with that.
Yeah, so I started off like most young Americans. I went to school, got a degree in something that you should not get a degree in, which is Japanese literature, because it was fun and I like reading books. Promptly realized that I did not want to do academia for a number of reasons, and that you can't really do anything with a bachelor's in any kind of literature. And so I became a translator. And so I spent a number of years just doing Japanese to English translation for like across like a wide range of topics. That was probably where I got like the sort of writing itch. Because translation kind of gets this perception that it's like you put something in one side, it comes out the other, and it's like a one-to-one whatever. But there's a lot of like finagling with like word choice and tone, and like the way in which you are choosing your words reflects a lot on the reader experience. And so like, what does your audience want to hear? What does your client need your audience to hear in order to get, like, meet the objective that they're trying to like meet? You're doing a lot of that kind of thinking with translation. I got kind of fed up with the like sort of relationships I would have with clients, because when a lot of people are hiring like an independent translator, the sort of relationship you have with them is like not actually too dissimilar from the relationship a lot of people have with their copywriter, where it's like, I need X deliverable, give me the deliverable, and not like, hey, you're a complex individual with a like a really specific skill set that can do a lot of different things, and so I'm going to give you the creative liberty to do this in the best way you think it's going to be most effective for me. But it's even less so because people like really do think it's just like a in one side, out the other kind of thing. And so I started in, I guess, 2019, like thinking about copywriting. I think like a lot of people, I was like, hey, this sounds like a fun thing. I can write good. Why not do some writing and make some money? And so I started taking some online marketing classes. That was great. Probably forgot about it because I was like, hey, I need money. So January of 2021, I'd all but forgotten about copywriting until I got a random ping on Discord because I joined a copywriting Discord server, which is the one we're always talking about. They were having a contest that was like a portfolio building contest in which like they were trying to get people to, over the course of 30 days, create like a sales page plus some Facebook ads plus some emails and do like some mini videos and stuff to create like a miniature funnel, with the prize being that they were going to hire a couple of the people who did really well on the project. When I saw the announcement, I was kind of ambivalent about it. I was like, oh, this looks like fun, but I'm an incredibly competitive person. And so once I started seeing the things that other people were submitting, I was like, oh, I can do way better than that. Despite the fact that I never read any sort of sales page intentionally, I'd read zero books on copywriting, done none of the stuff, but I was like, oh yeah, I can absolutely replicate that stuff better. And so procrastinated for 2 weeks. In like the last week of the contest, I like spent way too many hours digesting every single video that the runners of the contest have made. I read all of the content that everyone else who had submitted their stuff had submitted to the contest I created, and was like, okay, I'm just gonna write the stuff. And I got lucky, got an interview and got onboarded into the company that the two guys running the contest had created. And like, it was at that point that I actually started studying copy. And so since then, I've been doing all sorts of stuff from like emails to sales pages. Yeah, that's how I've gotten here. The contest itself was to create like a sort of framing to sell yourself as a copywriter. I had not used any of those materials whatsoever because after doing about like 1 week of studying copywriting, I realized that what I had written was like not that great. Like there were some like cool parts here and there, but on the whole, it was like not very impressive. And so I kind of had written it off. However, the place where I find my clients mostly now is through Upwork or like locally. Like I'll like cold email local businesses.
How many hours would you say you work per week now? And how much of that is self-development? How much of that is seeking clients? And how much of that is actually writing?
9 a.m. till maybe 6 p.m. every day. I'm not actively engaged in like doing stuff the entire time, but that's like the hours I've kind of set for myself. I have like 3-ish hours every day that I have like set aside for like reading books, writing stuff that's like practice or like reviewing old materials or courses or whatever, like personal development. I try to do at least 1 hour of like looking for clients or like new client acquisition. And then so the other two is like writing copy. Obviously like in the middle of a project or from like reaching a deadline, it's like way more of that's writing or I'll extend that way past. But yeah. One thing I would say about my experience is that like there are probably a lot of people out there who have been in a like copywriting adjacent field who like have some sort of writing skills, who like have a sense of like how you put words on a page. For people like that, the best thing you can do is really start studying marketing, basically. I was like pretty decent at the writing part, but my sense of like how these businesses are set up that I'm working with was not very great. Or like the business of copywriting, like conversions, like the idea that copy that converts is a thing is like not something I ever thought of as a translator, even though that was literally what I was doing. Your biggest ROI is going to be on the marketing side. I'd say first, figure out what you want to do. So if you are the kind of person who wants to work with individual clients in a specific industry, you definitely need to learn about the thing you're trying to write. This is like the research so that you can go and do research for your clients. The second is get like a solid base of like copywriting / marketing skills so that you can actually like do the job to like a minimal level. And then three is just like start putting yourself out there. I think there are a lot of copywriting gigs that don't require you to be a particularly skilled copywriter, but will make you significantly more skilled once you get them under your belt. Just like start doing the work so people can see that you're a hard worker.
What industry have you been focusing on recently? Because I know that you're more of a generalist.
Yeah.
But what industries have you been focusing on in the last few months?
The past few months has mostly been like e-commerce stuff. I really like going to people's homepages and be like, your homepage sucks. And this is why. big fan of criticism.
Why don't we go to Luke and you describe like how you discovered this weird business, what got you into it, how you got started, and like the steps along your way to landing a pretty sweet gig.
I do not come from a like language or communication background. I originally did software engineering in college, and then I studied psychology and statistics in university. During my studies, I sort of like got into like entrepreneurship, and I did some tech ventures, and I did a lot of entrepreneurial stuff. But I ran into the problem where I just did not know how to market whatever I created. So I discovered Dan Kennedy and I learned about copywriting, and it was very interesting to me. And I would say that that was sort of the moment where I started applying those principles to like my own business ventures or like my own business initiatives. I would say like about like a year after that, when I was like about to graduate from university, I was like, all right, well, I'm done with my studies now. I realized how hard it is to actually create your own business ventures. And I was like, I need money, you know, like I need to be able to support myself. So I had some cash in the bank and I decided, all right, well, I'm gonna do this thing that this Dan Kennedy guy was doing that he is earning a lot of money with. Like, I should be able to do the same thing, right? Because that was my rationale, right? I got on Upwork and I worked my ass off. I think I did 100-hour weeks for about 3 months at the start, but I got success pretty quickly where I was able to support myself pretty much from month one, just because I just put my full willpower on this one thing alone. And I guess after that, I just sort of like started learning the theory as I was going along with it. Like I just took on any gig that I was able to get, and I just tried to get as much experience under my belt as possible. I read a lot. I think I read like 20 copywriting books in like 3 months. I just worked a lot. And then I kind of got into a dip where I realized, okay, so I'm able to get clients, but nobody wants to keep hiring me. At least I had a couple of them. I had about 3 clients that were like, all right, like they kept giving me recurring work, but the majority of them just like, you know, I handed in my work and then they ghosted me. So I made the conclusion, okay, my copy kind of sucks, because if they don't want to like hire me, like, or if they're not giving me any more work, it must mean that my work isn't performing. Now, I don't know if it actually performed or not. I suspect it doesn't. I decided to like put my nose to the grindstone and really, really study copy. What I did is I followed the Agora Copy Camp, which is very intense. And I think I spent like 6 to 8 hours a day just purely studying long form sales letters. And I did that for about 2 months. And after that, by also studying marketing and by doing even more, I started discovering that I was actually able to perform and I was actually able to get results for my clients. And shortly after, I landed a very good gig. And I've been there now. I've been like, right now I'm doing marketing, I'm doing SEO, I'm doing copywriting, I'm doing like all these different things for one big company. And I'm in a very, very good position. I really like my job or my gig. And to the side, I'm also developing still some entrepreneurial stuff. Like I'm also doing some affiliate marketing, but most of my responsibilities are basically in marketing for a tech company. And I also handle their technical writing. When you're starting out, you're just kind of like more generalist. Like you're just kind of like doing everything you can. When I began, I did a lot of like home services jobs. Like I did writing for construction. I wrote for like land mowing businesses or solar businesses. But eventually I got here because like, I don't know, like because I did like technical stuff before, I was able to like really easily get into the tech space. So like that's something I would recommend people that don't originally have like a communications background to look at what you've been doing before, because you can easily leverage those, like that existing knowledge base that you got to copywriting as well, and then even earn more money than you did before. So that's sort of my story, I would say.
What you said, you know, take any job that you can possibly get. You know, We had Warren on the show, and that's basically been his strategy. Like, bro, I need to live. I will write anything for anyone. Just give me money. A lot of people get stuck there, I think, especially like in that like junior to intermediate phase. And I suspect that people like kind of just get comfortable doing that. And so like you see a lot of stories, especially in our copywriting, like, you know, I've been doing this freelancing for 5 years. Like it's impossible to make more than X number of small dollars and stuff like that.
Yeah.
But what you expressed is you noticed, oh, my clients aren't coming back to me. Yeah. And then you asked why. You recognize, I think, a very important fundamental aspect of the writing and marketing business, which is that we're not just writing like stories and stuff like that, like, you know, just to like jerk off into a puddle. Like we're actually doing this with intent.
Yeah.
why do I say some of the things that I say? You understood fundamentally that the purpose of copywriting, and regardless of the kind of copy that you're writing, is that it serves a business purpose. And writing that exists either serves a business's purpose to generate profits, or it's an expense. And you wanted to move to the profit side of that business. And so you went hard in the paint on like learning. Reading the comments, I immediately have regrets. But you understood that like you needed to skill up.
As you're learning copywriting, you're learning 2 different skills. Like you're learning how to like acquire new clients, so like sort of the sales, and you're also learning how to write good copy. For me, like the acquiring new clients was something that came very natural to me. Like I don't know why, but like people seem to like spending money on me, so that went pretty easily for me. But like I noticed that like I wasn't able to fulfill as well because just people weren't coming back. So I realized, okay, I need to like get better as a copywriter. And honestly, the Agora Copy Camp really helped. I don't necessarily think you need to follow that. I think what it just really just comes down to is you should study copy really well. Like you should like annotate copy and you should reverse engineer it. And like, honestly, like the whole read one piece of copy or one long form sales letter a day is really good advice. And I would definitely give that advice to anyone who finds themselves into that like intermediate stage, because I know how hard that stage is. But like the only way to really get out is just like focus on that, like level up as a copywriter. And then if you want to get to the really advanced stages, you know, like the six figure plus stages, I would say like learn how to do the marketing as well. Because if you can do the marketing and the copywriting, your value as a freelancer or as a consultant or as an employee or whatever just multiplies. Because if you understand that, you understand the whole big picture.
If you go like really hard, you'll be able to pick up the basics that you need in about 2 months. But that's two hard, hard months.
When I started, I mean, like, for me, like, just like you said with Warren, it was just a like a necessity to earn money. So I just put in 100 hours a week. Like, I'm not kidding. I just woke up and like I was at it until midnight. And that's what I did for several months. You'll also look back at it and be like, ah, those are pretty good times, you know, because like you do learn how to do it well. You do learn how to sustain yourself. And I think for anyone that wants to become a copywriter, it's a really good feeling when you can prove to yourself, like, yes, I can make money from what I do. And yes, like I can survive in this market.
Now, when you say that you were doing 100 hour weeks, like that sounds really intimidating. But like, I imagine that some people out there right now are thinking, oh, he was just like writing for 100 hours a week. But like, what was the breakdown of like what that week was like? Were you spending 60 hours pitching jobs and 40 hours working? Was that like an 80-20 thing? Like, what did your life look like?
I mean, like, cause I read the Gary Halbert letters, I made sure to do my morning road work. So I always did that. But then after that, I would like definitely like pitch clients for like 2-3 hours. Like I would just send like, I literally sent like 50 proposals a day, like just until I got work. And my writing hours, like I would literally just write for like 10 hours straight if I had to. Like I had no problem doing that. I wouldn't recommend that for everyone, but I just went at it. Like if I had to write a whole day, like I didn't mind at all. I was able to like get so many clients at the start that I was literally doing that every day. Like I was just writing many hours every day. So it really was just a lot of writing. I mean, like now, obviously, like I don't go like to that extreme level anymore, but like still a lot of my time is dedicated to output. Like I still think that for any copywriter, if you want to make good money, you should be writing a lot. Like you should be trying to develop your output. I also think if you write every day, you will get better at writing fast and you will get better at writing quality content. It's funny because like someone in our Discord asked like what we think our best strengths are. And like for me, I definitely just say like output, just being able to like consistently write every day and putting words on paper. Cause I think that's one of the biggest differentiator in getting your success as a copywriter or not. It's kind of like abrasive, I guess, but I always just say read more, write more. Cause like, honestly, that's kind of what you need to do if you want to get better as a copywriter. It's like it's very simplified, but still, like if you do that, like you're gonna get somewhere, I can guarantee it.
The problem with that is that it takes work, and I think that copywriting has been so often marketed as like you don't need to work very much to actually make a ton of money. Like you can like sit with your feet in the sand and make a. And what people don't realize, like two things. One, like that's the end. There's a huge learning curve that you have to sort of traverse along the way. But it's true, it's possible, and I've done it. I literally can, you know, show you guys later a picture of me with like a piña colada and like me working on an email in on a white sand beach in Panama with like a lovely blue like coastline like right in front of me. It really is a sort of like 25/8/366 kind of job. Oh, you're writing on the beach or from the beach because you have to be available to your clients from wherever or whenever in the world you are. Yeah, I wrote on the beach. I lived the dream, but it's because there was a promo that needed like some lifts associated with it urgently. Even though I was, quote, on vacation. I haven't taken a vacation since like 2015, 2014. Even if I'm going abroad or going somewhere else, I'm still always working. I'm still always on. And you have to be if you want to be successful.
I do think you get more respect though, like if you get on. Like when I started, I definitely like, cause like I'm in like a European time zone. So like with like most of my clients are American, or like most of my clients have been American. Yeah. And Like when I started, like I definitely like had to like pick up calls at like 2 a.m. and like I just had to deal with it, even if it was like a couple $100 gig. Like that's just like how it goes, right? But like now, like as I notice that like I am better and that people see that I put out quality work, they're much more lenient and much more respectful of my time. Like they're like, oh, like you're in EU, so we're gonna make sure that in our mornings we talk with you, so like you don't have to be up like super late at night. But like definitely as a beginner, like just like do anything, you know, like stay up all night if you have to. I do want to give some pushback to Sean, because like I do think that it gets better as you get better, you know.
Oh yeah.
I don't think the 100-hour work week grind is forever.
No, that's what I was trying to say. There's initial hump, but then yeah. You do kind of always have to be on after. Like you don't have to like work 100 hours a week once you get good. But like that initial hump is, I think, where most people dip out and like lose interest in this particular business.
Yeah, I think pretty much anyone can be like a copywriter that earns like around $30,000 a year. I think that's pretty doable for most people. But like the moment you start pushing away from that, it's a grind. Like if you want to push like beyond that, like I guess that threshold, you're like you need to be prepared to put in the work. And that's a lot of work. Like, it's a lot of fucking work.
I think that goes back to something I wanted to talk about earlier in the conversation, too. In order to get clients that recur, what you really need is to find clients that have recurring work that they need. And so, like what we mean when we say, like, provide value is, like, provide value beyond just, like, literally writing something. It is, like, how are you adding profits to them by, like, thinking about, like, other ways in which you can contribute that is not just, like, literally writing the thing. And so like you need to have the skill set that allows you to say, hey, if we position this thing in this way, or hey, if we use this kind of funnel, we can like do this thing more efficiently that will generate more stuff. And the kind of person who's going to be receptive to you suggesting that kind of thing is the kind of person who is probably going to have multiple campaigns, or who could be convinced to have multiple campaigns.
Yeah, I was pulling more all-nighters in my early career than I ever did at university. I would work. And I would just work and work and work and work and work. And I'm not talking like, oh, I'm going to pitch some clients, because I worked in-house. So I was like, I'm going to work on this report. I'm going to develop this report. I'm going to develop this report. Yeah. I'm going to like research this to parlay into this. I'm going to hit like these 12 deadlines like that are due tomorrow. I don't think I would recommend that for many people, because I don't think people can go as hard or want to go as hard as I did. But I definitely found that like all the moments where I would just be right at the cusp of burnout were also the moments where I found my capacity stretching.
Yep.
My bandwidth is like different for different kinds of activities. And so let's say I get burned out after writing one blog post. It may not be very effortful for me to like then write like a Facebook ad, or for me to read a book, or, you know, do whatever. If you have enough variety in the tasks and your tasks tend to be generally productive, you can get a lot of stuff done even if you're not spending a ton of time on each individual thing. And if you're also kind of stretching as you do those things, your capacity to do lots of different stuff like increases a lot.
I do think there are also like different productivity styles. Like I'm someone that can just like sit down and like work at one thing for like many hours, but like most people don't like that style. So like also find like what works for you. Some people like to switch around between things a lot. Other people just like have like 3 hour like bursts, but I like to just sit down, work for like 8 to 10 hours, and then I'm like, I'm done.
Like going to the gym, there are days you don't feel like lifting, and you gotta kind of compel yourself to just do it. With writing, it's the exact same thing. I use a tool called Write or Die, which is, it literally, like, you have to type something onto this interface, or it will start screaming at you. And like, I'm not going to say that's going to work for everybody, but it works for me on those days where I'm just like, okay, like this is just a slog. You're going to have days like that, and you have to figure out the ways that are going to get you personally through that. There are a lot of paths into this career. There's no one path. And so it really doesn't matter what you do to get started, so long as you get started. Start pressing down on the gas pedal and start studying, start working at something, start deliberately and in a focused manner trying to cultivate this skill. You're going to get somewhere. So my story, It's time. Important facets of this. Dad and grandfather were stockbrokers, so grew up hanging out in a actual brokerage firm. Investing was a thing that I learned pretty early. College, I started out as a math major, then was a music major, and then was an English major. I basically got a double major. It was like an honors program where it was a double in English and continental philosophy. So I got my bachelor's degree in California, Los Angeles, doing that. Worked at a pharmaceutical company for a little bit. Traveled the American South with the actor Sean Penn a little bit. Moved to San Francisco for a little while. Went back to Los Angeles. Got a master's degree in English. While I was doing that, I was also studying linguistics at the same time and also studying pedagogy, where they teach you to teach. So I started actually teaching classes while I was getting my first master's degree. And so was a college professor at the age, I think, of like 23 or 24. Got accepted to the University of Illinois for their MFA program in creative writing. I wanted to study there because I wanted to study with the author Richard Powers, which I got to. That was really cool. Did that for 3 years. Also taught while I was there. Got married while I was in Illinois. Didn't end up teaching more classes because she got into med school in Miami. I moved from Illinois after getting my MFA to Miami, taught there, was making so little money teaching, even though I was working 50, 60 hours. So that was miserable. I literally like picked up a job like waiting tables along the side, was grading papers in my server book. And this is in like 2015, where I was like, I don't know if teaching is for me. So I started putting myself out there on a freelance basis, literally on Craigslist. Being like, hey, I'm a writer, I write things. This is what I do. Also was entering a lot of like creative writing contests and winning them, which was pretty cool. And so I was making money that way, like writing some articles and stuff like that for rich people who wanted to see their names in print. So like vanity press kind of stuff. And then I saw a job, like just looking for jobs on Indeed.com for a part-time proofreader at a place called Palm Beach Research Group. And so I was like, oh, proofreading, I can do that. Got a job there and I literally showed up with like my resume and writing samples and all that. The interviewer was just like, yeah, you're exactly the kind of person that we want to hire. You're hired. I didn't even ask me a question. And so I got to the job. It was my first like real office job. And just so everybody understands, Agora is a conglomerate. And so all these different divisions operate more or less independently. And so Agora is like that. There's Palm Beach Research. There was Palm Beach Research Group. They're their own thing now. Stansberry. There was Agora Financial. There was Money Map. Like they have their own CEO, typically called the publisher. They have their own CMO. So they all operate more or less independently, though they all use centralized services from Agora. I started working at Palm Beach Research Group in like October of 2015. In November of 2015, I noticed that there was this cool little newsletter that they published called Creating Wealth. The head guru of that was a guy named Mark Ford, who used to go by the name of Michael Masterson. And the cool thing about that newsletter is that it had like briefs, like reviews and book reviews and stuff like that. And so I was like, oh, like I can write some stuff like that. And so without even knowing the people that were managing that particular franchise, the Creating Wealth franchise, I just like in my spare time while I was writing for proofing projects, just started writing articles and just sent them to the managing editors being like, hey, like, you know, I know you're probably hungry for content. If you ever feel like publishing a this, well, here you go. The managing editors of that franchise brought this to Mark Ford's attention. And they were like, hey, Sean, we know you're a part-time proofer. How about we kick your salary up to like, it was like 40 or 45K, give you full benefits, and you're an assistant managing editor now. I was like, bet. I just kept doing stuff. But by the middle of 2016, I started on an intensive research project on how to invest in tax liens. Basically, I wrote a series of three reports that eventually became bonuses for future sales letters. What I did was I just like went to places, interviewed people, talked to friends, got them to take pictures of like different properties, like really did boots on the ground research. I think my income had been bumped to $80,000 a year because like they were like, oh, Sean's dope. And I was like, bet. Mark Ford, who I had become more and more acquainted with, was like, listen, I'm not happy with my franchise being with Palm Beach Research Group. I want to either spin it off or attach it to some other Agora affiliate. And he was like, I want you to be the person in charge of doing that. And I was like, all right, yeah, I can be your Huckleberry. The next day, the managing director and copy chief of Palm Beach Research Group invited me out to lunch and said, Sean, and these are exact words, Sean, I don't know if you're going to be a great copywriter, but I think you're going to be at least a good one. And he said, like, I want you to start as a copywriter for Palm Beach Research Group. The first thing that I'm going to have you do for the first 2 months is just handwriting, like, End of America and things like that. Well, Mark already asked me and I already promised him. And man of my word, yada yada. So I'm sorry, but you're a day late. By being, like, moved to being in charge of the Creating Wealth franchise, like, I also was in charge of managing 5 or 6 international affiliates. And so managing those relationships, producing content that they could publish to their own subscribers across the world. That's one of the reasons why I got to travel so much was, like, I would help produce copy for this franchise in America. And then I would have to go to, like I got to meet with the publisher of the Indian affiliate of Agora, Equity Master. And, like, he's great. Rahul is great. Nepotism is real. I know people, and people know me, and they know that I am more or less capable of stuff. Once you know people and have those relationships and have good recurring relationships, the snowball gets bigger and bigger and bigger so fast. Oh, yeah. And Luke, I think you can attest to that too. I had a sit down lunch with Joe Schrieffer. First time we met in Baltimore, like, we just hit it off. He basically said, like, hey, bring Creating Wealth into Agora Financial and then learn how to write copy, because I expect all my publishers, CEOs to know how to write copy, and we'll launch your business. We'll launch Mark's business under Agora Financial. So I was like, bet. And around the same time, my ex-wife was graduating from medical school and she got into her residency in New York. And so starting from about August of 2017, I began commuting every single week between New York and Baltimore, which is about a 2.5 hour train ride. So I would go down on Sundays, I would go back on Wednesday nights. I reviewed the tapes of the first copy camp that took place, and then I was in attendance for the next one. Really intense, multi-hour sessions, and then you were expected to just do 3 things every single day. Write an idea per day, write a single page of copy per day, and read and annotate a sales letter every single day. And if you do those things, regardless of whether you're freelance, regardless of whether you're in-house, regardless of what kind of copy you're trying to learn, you are going to skill up rapidly. Especially if you're getting some of the theory along the way. While I was doing all of that, I was also working on my first sales letter to launch the Creating Wealth business under Agora Financial. One of the things that Joe Schrieffer did was he assigned the sort of pretty famous copywriter David Deutsch to be my mentor. So, like, I would write copy and then I would send it to him and he'd be like, this is fucking terrible and you should be ashamed. And I would be like, bet? But I was also getting tips and advice from, like, Joe Schrieffer himself, from Addison Wiggin, from Pete Coyne, the former publisher of Paradigm Press. People were more than willing to help me. It was a really good environment to learn. I launched a business, literally, like, wrote all the editorial, I wrote all the marketing copy, I wrote all the sales letters, all of it. Launched. It was middling. It was mediocre. This was around the time that, like, crypto was really big. And at the same time, in November of 2017, Mark Ford emailed me and everybody and said, like, actually, I'm retiring. Well, balls. Like, I just did all this work. And, like, I built this business and launched this business for Mark Ford. And, like, he wants to retire now. But it was fine. So in 2018, the publisher Doug Hill, who basically was just like, so what's in the cards for you? What do you want to do? And I was like, focus on copy, I guess, for a little bit. And he was like, want to write some copy for me? And I was like, bet. I did that for a couple of years, studied, like, webinar copy, wrote a few successful webinars. My first $1 million promo was a webinar for James Altucher. That doesn't mean I got paid 7 figures. That means that I got a cut of 7 figures. Yeah. And so now, as of May 2020, I went freelance. I write editorial copy for one of the former affiliates of Creating Wealth, which launched, as a result of reports that I wrote, its own financial publishing business. And so I'm one of the chief gurus there. I also have launched my own Agora affiliate, DIYWealth.com, where I'm the main guru there. And then I also have been picking up freelance copywriting jobs on the side, not only for Agora Financial, but also for other trading gurus. And that's my story. That's the full trajectory of mine.
It's funny because, like, in that, I hear a lot of, like, the same things that led to this show happening, where it's like you got a bunch of people who get together in a space and they all demonstrate some minimal level of competence or interest in a thing. And, you know, they're all friendly and like, hey, we like this thing. Let's do this thing together.
I think a common thread is the almost devotion to, like, copywriting or copy, at least for a little while.
Show up. like, be present. Like, make yourself known. Like, don't be, like, you know, silent in the background type. Like, be a squeaky wheel so that you get some grease. The show, this, what we're doing every single week, is free and more than enough to kickstart somebody's career. The information that we give, including the music copy episode, fuckers, that nobody watched. I hope that the stories that we shared in this particular episode have been helpful to the people that have been listening now or in our post-apocalyptic future. I suspect that a lot of the people who ask questions on our copywriting, on the Discord, in this channel, everywhere on the web, when they ask, like, how do I get started as a copywriter? How do I start my copywriting career? How do I quick start it? Yada, yada, yada. I suspect that a lot of them have probably seen 4 or 5 how to begin your copywriting career videos. The sad, hard truth is that you just need to start it and start failing and start trying. All right, I'm ending the stream. Have a wonderful, wonderful week. Go make some money, guys. Take care.